Yeah, there we go. This week we're talking about faithfulness. What does faithfulness mean? It means being devoted, being committed to, giving oneself fully to what you believe in. This week, my son, I'm so proud to say, I think, devoted himself fully to the task of being a teacher as part of Ag Week at the school that he teaches. And they ended up with an Ag Olympics. And of course, he put himself fully into the competition, seniors against teachers. And it was called Izzy Dizzy. And this is what happened. Now watch it again and watch his hand at the end there. Breaking her heart, now I'm free. Now that's devotion, isn't it? And he put his hand out because he realized as he was falling and sliding that he was still going to cross the finish line before the senior kid, and he did. So... The next morning, he told me about it, and I didn't realize the kids in the gym are the ones who filmed it, and then they put this song to it and slowed it down. It's great, and it's on Facebook, and he called me next morning and said, Mom, I woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning, and I couldn't breathe. I couldn't breathe, I couldn't move, and I was so worried. So he took himself to the emergency room, and he's bruised all his ribs. Sometimes faithfulness costs us a lot.
There I was on death row, guilty in the first degree. Son of God hanging on a hill, hell was my destiny. The crowd was shouting, crucify, could have come from these lips of mine. Dirty shame was killing me. It would take a miracle to wash me clean. Then I
today we want to welcome, we're celebrating Scout Sunday, and we want to welcome Scout BSA Troop 950 that this church is sponsoring. Yes, it's a girls' troop, and we are so happy that they are here with us today. Let's show them their our appreciation. And we may well be, in the next few weeks, also sponsoring a boys' cub pack again. So, awesome to have. Huh? Co-ed? Oh, okay. All right. So, anyway, a cub pack here again. And I'm thrilled with that.
Thank you very much, Scout Troop, for collecting our noisy collection today. And welcome again. And for those who don't know me, my name is Terry Huff, and I'm so thankful that you made it out on this windy Sunday, the greatest day of the week that we can come together and serve God and worship Him. And I'm so glad you chose us for worship today. Do we have any first-time visitors? If so, we got a gift for you. It's a really nice gift that the congregation have put together. Just raise your hand, and the ushers will bring you just a real quick gift. Anybody? All right, then. We will stand and greet one another with the love that Jesus has placed in your hearts. As you make your way back to your seats, let me remind you to please sign the attendance cards in the booklets at the end of the pews. So now, let our minds and our hearts be in tune with the worship today as the prelude begins. Thank you. Please stand, if you are able, for the call of worship. Praise the Lord, all you nations. Exalt him, all you peoples. Praise the Lord. Now let us say the opening prayer together. Lord Jesus, help us to walk in humanity, stand firm in our faith, no matter what we face. May we never forget the blessings and the faithfulness you have left our families, our church, and all who call on your names. Help us to remain faithful. Amen.
Thank you.
I'm at the back now because either I can cause less trouble from there or I'm closer to the angels. I'm not sure which, but that's what I like to think anyway. As the ushers come forward, we are going to take up our morning tithes and offerings. Keep it to yourself. Let us pray. Oh Lord, we thank you for all the blessings that you give us. And Lord, let us now give back to you just a portion of what you bless us with. May you bless this offering, multiply it, and let it spread throughout the world to help your people. In your name we pray. Amen. So upstairs, you're going to be talking about faithfulness. What does it mean to be faithful? It means you have to be dedicated and devoted to something or someone more than anything else. So tell me some things that you're faithful in. What things are important to you?
Musical,
all right. And if you miss a practice, what happens?
Yeah.
Right, right. Yes, so if you're not there during Tech Week, you're out, right? And also, if you miss, then you miss some movements or a song, and you don't know what you're doing. Okay, what's important to you? Football. Okay, you got to practice hard, don't you? Yes, you do. Otherwise, you're going to miss one of the plays, and then you're not going to know what happens, right? What? Oh, well, yes. What else? What's important to you, Aaron? T-ball. All right. And you have to go to all those practices, don't you? Or you're going to not learn something. Right. You're going to do T-ball again. Excellent. So you're going to be dedicated and committed, right? What is something that's important to you? Your new shoes, not to get dirty. I know, you and Aaron have the same kind of shoes. All right. Well, you know what? We say we're committed to something, but sometimes another opportunity comes up. When I had youth at a different church, I would get phone calls, or texts, I'm not coming tonight because so-and-so is having a party and I want to go there. That's not very committed, is it? How do you think God feels when we say we love you, God, and then we totally ignore what God's telling us? He's pretty sad. And when we say we're committed to God, we'd better be committed to God first over everything else. You're going to learn about that today. So let's put our hands together and we're going to pray. Oh Lord, thank you for these children. We thank you for their hearts, their minds. For they show us the way to the kingdom of God. Be with them and with Tracy upstairs as they learn all about faithfulness. And go with them this week that they may show faithfulness to others. In your name we pray. Amen. Walk, Aaron, okay? Make sure you walk. As we begin our prayer time, I want to tell you I'm excited about some news, and that is that we are holding our third annual fish fry, April the 4th. The leadership team has divided all the responsibilities up, and they're going to take charge of it. Not me, they're going to take charge of it. And everybody's invited. We'll have sign-up sheets next week. We will have tickets. And Renita is going to head up the tickets, so she'll be here next week, not tomorrow. Don't worry. You don't have to come to church 2 days in the week. And she will tell you about those, and we'll have tickets for sale. Let's make this as prosperous as it has been in the past. And while I'm on that, in your tower notes, which Erica works so hard to put together, especially when people like me are late in handing their articles in, and she waits, and then she just hounds you, and that's what she's supposed to do. Anyway, there was a slight error, and it says that the fish fry is to pay off the organ. That's not true. It's already been paid for. It's just that she forgot to delete that line, so give her a break. And it's a fundraiser for the church. It'll go in the general fund for when we need it, which could be any time. General conference has begun. I spent a long time yesterday listening. I have never, ever heard of a general conference or even a annual conference like ours spending the first day in nothing but prayer and worship. As I listened, the African contingent came and prayed and sang in African, different African languages. The Philippines did the same thing. Contingents from all over the world, the different languages that were going up, the praise and the worship. My house was filled with praise and worship. It was awesome. And that's all in preparation for the hard work they have for the next 3 days. A letter was sent out, or a prayer rather, was sent out to pastors to ask all congregations, United Methodist congregations, to say this prayer at our prayer time, and I am going to read that, and we're going to pray. And I'm also going to read the names of our delegates, because we need to lift them up. They have some hard decisions to make. And we're going to pray that the Holy Spirit guides them, that they're not doing something on their own. That's the prayer that we need to have. Before that, I have some other prayer concerns. Haley and Keeley turn 17 tomorrow. That is hard to believe, isn't it? They don't act like it, but they turn 17 anyway. I got you guys. Yes. Let us remember Norm Titus. He was here in the first service, and he took off right away to go over to Indiana. And apparently, the turnpike, the Ohio Turnpike, is closed, and that's how he gets over to Indiana, because of the wind. So let us remember all those who are driving, especially semis, and it's very dangerous out there right now. Dale Cook and Linda need our prayers. He is having a heart cath done on Thursday. He only has 30% heart function. And with all the other issues he's dealing with, being under anesthetic is not going to be good. So let us remember not only Dale, but Linda and the whole family. We also need to lift up Deb. Deb, I don't know if you're trying to be the one who's most in our prayer concerns, but you have had, I know you're not. You have had so much stuff going on. But the stuff that was going on in her lungs has now been identified as cancer. She is going to be having surgery in March, so we want to lift up her and her family. And Brian, you've got to get well so you can take care of her, and we don't want to see your names on the prayer list much longer, you know? Renee Zubler, that's Tom's sister, she is back in the hospital again. She has pneumonia and a collection of fluid that is infected from the radiation treatment for her cancer. Let us lift up Renee. She has had a battle for a long time. Really pray for her. And Charlene asks us to pray for Eric McWade, who has tests and surgery on his stomach. Beth Martin is in Marion Manor, and I have been told since first service, when I went to see her this week, she was not good. She was not having a good day. But then somebody was there yesterday and said she was bright and shiny and cheerful. So let's just remember her, because I don't know if she's ever going to get to come home. And just lift her up. If you have a chance to visit, she loves visitors and she's lonely. Dick Kiefer is back in the hospital. He is not good. All we really know is that he had an infection and was given some strong antibiotics, was out of the hospital for a few days, and now he's back. So we don't really know what's going on, but he was completely out of his mind when I saw him yesterday. He wasn't making any sense. He did let me pray with him. He was very accepting of that. And here is what he shouted right before that. God, take me home. I want to go home. The nurse thought he was talking about his home on Brightwood. But you and I know that Dick for a long time has been praying that God will call his name and take him to his heavenly home. So remember him and just pray for whatever God's will is to be done. Jeff Beveridge has surgery this week. And I need to give you an update of Bob and Janet Lucas. So they're both at Kingston. Janet's dementia, I almost forgot that word, maybe I have that too, but Janet's dementia has got worse. And unfortunately, she's become combative. You know, that happens sometimes with dementia slash Alzheimer's. So they have now put her in the memory unit at Kingston, but unfortunately she became combative there, so they sent her to a psychiatric hospital in Columbus, and I believe she's now back. She is responding very well to medicines, and I believe she's back at the memory unit. And Bob is now sharing a room with Jim Eckel, so who is now back at the nursing home. So if you think about them, send them a card. They need to know their church is still praying for them. There are three prayer shawls here on the front, one for Janet Lucas, one for Betty Lucas, and one for Merwin Mosier, who is not doing well either. If you would like during prayer time to come and pray over them, or any time during the service or after the service, please do that, and then they will be delivered. I think that's it. Let us go to the Lord in prayer today. Gracious and loving God, who leads, teaches, and guides, you who offer compassion, grace, and mercy, be with us now. We passionately seek your presence during challenging times and circumstances, and we trust that you are moving in and around our lives. We, as one part of your body, the church, go into the days and weeks ahead, seeking to discern your deep desire for us as the United Methodist Church. Give us courage as we continue to live and respond to your invitation to be your hands, feet, and voice. We ask for a fresh wind of your spirit and guidance for each of us as individuals, for the faithful congregations, and for this global community of United Methodists. We ask for your wisdom and presence for those among us who have been called to serve as delegates and our Council of Bishops as the special session of General Conference begins today and lasts through Tuesday. Grant them clarity and a discerning spirit as they seek to listen for you in their midst. Reveal to them your deep desire for our future as a church. Give them and us the faith to lay aside our personal wants and needs so that we can be truly present to you, sit with you in reverence and awe, and listen deeply for the still small voice that woos us, comforts us, and invites us to that place where we can live fully and wholly into the kingdom life that you desire for us. We lay all this before you as the deep desire of our hearts and minds.
And we lift up especially our own delegates, that you may lead them in what they say, what they think, and how they respond. We remember our clergy, Amy Aspie, Chris Heckerman, Roger Grace, Mike Slaughter, Karen Cook, Connell Graham, Dee Stickley Minor, Doug Dameron, Wade Giffen, and Greg Stover. And we ask you to put your hands upon our lay representatives, Caleb Harper, George Howard, Philip Moots, Kathy Rawls, Joy Perry, Bill Brownson, Chris Steiner, Harris Tay, Lindsay Stearns, and Marilyn Bridges. And Lord, we lift up all the people that we have mentioned in our own congregation and those that we have asked prayer for today. Pour your love into these prayer shawls, Lord, that they may be a comfort to those who receive them. Be with those in hospital, those recovering from surgery. Be with our shut-ins. Be with all who are out and about, and especially those driving in this terrific wind, Lord. And Lord, we pray for the United Methodist Church once again. We know what we believe, Lord, for we have studied what we believe for the last 30 weeks. We stand on that. Help us to be faithful in it, that our words and our actions may be that of your Holy Spirit, and that we may stay together as one church, continuing to love you and be devoted to you and you alone. We ask all this in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And now together, as the body of Christ, let us say the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand if you are able. Today's scripture reading comes to us from Matthew 8, verses 5 through 13. When Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him asking for help. Lord, he said, my servant lies at home paralyzed in terrible suffering. Jesus said to him, I will go and heal him. The centurion replied, Lord, I do not deserve to have you to come under my roof, but just say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes. And that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard this, he said in astonishment and said to those following him, I tell you the truth, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. I say to you that many will come from the east and the west and will take their place at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness, where there will be the weeping and the gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, "Go, and it will be done just as you believe it would." And his servant was healed that very hour. This is the word of God from the people of God today. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord, open up our ears, our eyes, our hearts, our spirit, and let us be one with you. Teach us today, give us a word to encourage our faithfulness so we may be more devoted to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Exodus 34:6 says, "The Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, is slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness." Joshua 24:14 says, "Fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness." Psalm 89:8 says, "Who is like you, Lord God Almighty? You, Lord, are mighty, and your faithfulness surrounds you." And Isaiah 25:1 says, "Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name, for in perfect faithfulness you have done wonderful things, things planned long ago." Friends, our God is faithful. Can I get an amen there? He will never leave us, never forsake us, never cause us harm. He loves us even when we do not love ourselves, and always keeps his promises. God is always faithful, even when we are not. That's the God we serve. And my belief is that our church is going to remain here and continue to grow in faithfulness in years to come. The eighth fruit of the Spirit is faithfulness. But what is faithfulness? If you look it up, you find words like dedicated, devoted, loyal, unfailing, constant, perseverance. Those qualities are hard to find in people today, aren't they? People start a job and then quit because they don't want to get up early or work over or whatever it is in the job they don't like. Faithfulness is what we value and believe in as most important. And then you combine that with commitment. Someone wrote, "Success in God's kingdom is loving God, loving one another, and being faithful to what God has called us to." Are we faithful people? Oswald Chambers wrote, "To be faithful means that we only have one loyalty, the Lord Jesus Christ." Is that the first thought in your mind when you wake up? The last thought when you go to bed? In between, how many different thoughts do you have? And is it ever what I do and say has to be for the Lord Jesus Christ? Oswald Chambers also said, the goal of faithfulness is not that we work for God, but that God will be free to do his work through us. So what does faithfulness really mean? Does it mean we have faithfulness because we have faith? Not necessarily. Faith is a gift from God given to us when we believe in Jesus Christ. God gives us that gift of faith. But faithfulness is our response to our faith. It's what we do with what we believe. Many people say we're stepping out in faith. So how do we do that? Faithfulness is one of the last five, the second lot of five fruits, where others see Christ in us. We don't have to walk around with a label saying, today I'm showing faithfulness. We're done with patience. Don't have to do that anymore. We're done with kindness and goodness. No, these build on each other, and it's not forgetting one. It is building on it and adding faithfulness. The story of the centurion coming to Jesus shows faithfulness. So I want to focus on that story today. Not only is it told in Matthew's gospel that we heard today, but it's also told in Luke 7, 1 through 10. And Luke tells a little bit different of a version, and I'm going to point out the main things that he says different as we go along. Let's take a look at this centurion. A legion of soldiers was 6,000 men. And there was at least a legion in Jerusalem all the time. A legion was comprised of 60 centuries, each one with a centurion, which is why they're called centurions, over 100 men. These centurions were chosen because they were the finest men in the Roman army. The Roman army was huge, so to be chosen as a centurion was a huge honor. They were responsible for the discipline of all 100 of their men. If one of them messed up, then you, as a centurion, were in trouble. They must command with authority. They must be steadfast in action, not over anxious to go into battle, but prepared to die if need be, and they must be reliable. God calls us to be centurions for him. How are you doing so far on the requirement list? A centurion was loyal to the emperor, to Caesar, to Rome, and the Roman Empire. In the New Testament, you may not know this, there is mentioned seven centurions, and every single one of them is mentioned with honor. This centurion could be the greatest. He comes to Jesus, we hear in Matthew, as Jesus enters Capernaum, which is his hometown, where he's chosen to live. They use Peter's home or Peter's mother's home as a base there. And as he enters, this centurion comes up to him. Now in Luke's gospel, the centurion actually never comes to Jesus. He sends two Jewish elders to speak to Jesus for him. Now doesn't that seem odd? Why would a Roman in such good standing, send Jewish leaders to Jesus. And in Luke's gospel, these Jewish leaders say, he's a good man. You need to help him. He helped us build our synagogue. He built the church for the Jews in their town. What a man this centurion must have been. And he either comes himself or sends these Jewish elders with one task. He tells Jesus, I have a servant or a slave who is sick. He's suffering. He's in pain. I'm sure there were many in the crowd who said, well, why are you even bothered about him? Because in those days, servants, slaves, they were considered the same and were worth absolutely nothing. If you had a sick servant, you would just kill them or put them out on the street because they weren't producing for you. Can you imagine? You cannot imagine that today. And yet, we treat people like that. Aristotle said, a slave is a living tool, just as a tool is an inanimate slave. There is to be no friendship, no justice. That is the world in which this centurion is living. And yet he comes forward begging, pleading Jesus to heal him. He loved his slave. And Jesus is astounded. Here is this Roman who isn't supposed to have anything to do with Gentiles. And yet, because either he came face to face with Jesus or even sent someone, shows how much trust he has in Jesus. He believes in him. He not only believed in Jesus, but he believed in the powerful things that he has heard that Jesus does. And he makes this funny statement. I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. Now today we would think, well, that's kind of weird. We would say, we're not worthy of Jesus, which is true. He says, I do not deserve to have you under my roof. In those times, it was illegal for a Jew to enter a Gentile house. Anybody who wasn't a Jew was not allowed to enter their house. So in this story, we see the faithfulness that Jesus shows because he's willing to go anyway because he said, I'm coming. And we see the faithfulness of the Jew who doesn't want Jesus to defile himself. And he in fact says, I am not worthy to have you come into my house. He understood the importance of Jesus and how unfit he was. And then he says, but you don't have to come. All you have to do is say the word. I am a commander of 100 men, and when I say go, people go. And when I say come, people come. I wish it worked that way with our children and grandchildren. Wouldn't that be awesome? But they have to be acting like that, because otherwise, for anybody who's been in the military, I know, otherwise you're not conditioned. This man knows the power that Jesus has and says, all you have to do is to say the word and my servant will be healed. And Jesus' response is, I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith. Jesus and those around him only knew the faith of the centurion because he was being faithful. He set aside everything else for for the health and safety and healing of his slave. Jesus said that all those in Israel, the ones who were promised the kingdom of God, didn't show such faith because they automatically thought they would go to heaven. You know what? We Christians are the same way. Many times we think, well, I'm a Christian, so I'm going to get into heaven. But that person over there that never goes to church, that doesn't act right, isn't. Jesus turns the kingdom on its head. And he says all those who think they're automatically going to get in will only see darkness and gnashing of teeth. I don't want gnashing of teeth, do you? Jesus said, this man has shown his faithfulness. He will be welcomed into God's kingdom, not because he is automatically in there, but because the centurion was saved by grace through his faith. And just having faith isn't enough. We must live in faithfulness, living out our faith in everything we do, making Jesus our priority, so that everyone will know who we are, whose we are, and what we stand for. Do you have the faithfulness of the centurion? Let us pray. Lord our God, we think that coming to church makes us faithful. We may be faithfully coming and attending, but it's the relationship that we have with you that really counts. So, Lord, enable us to be able to dig deep into our hearts, our souls. Let us take time every day just to be with you and build that relationship. Let us learn to listen more and talk less. Let our actions, our words, our inactions, and when we choose to be silent, show our faithful witness to all those we meet. In your name we pray. Amen. Let us stand and sing our final hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. God is faithful. Aren't you glad about that? So let us be faithful to each other, to God, to our church. And if you want to know what's happening with conference, all you have to do is put in your search engine GC, that's for General Conference 2019, and it will take you to the page. You can live stream, you can look up what's recently been passed. It's all on that particular page. Keep informed. And don't listen to what's going on in the regular media, because they won't get it right. I'm just telling you, okay? Let us pray. Lord, you are faithful in so many ways to us. Teach us, encourage us, help us in our own faithfulness to you and for you. Allow us to be those instruments to allow your love to flow through us to others. And may everything we say and do be for you. We leave this place knowing that you are before us, behind us, beside us. And we ask this prayer in the name of God the Father, Jesus the Son, and in the power of the Holy Spirit, and all God's people say, Amen. Amen.